Penguin Random House Audio presents Kings of Their Own Ocean, Tuna, Obsession, and the Future of Our Seas. This is the author, Karen Pinchin. Dead, in front of me, catafalqued king of my own ocean. A well-oiled ship of the wind, the only true machine of the sea. Unflawed, undefiled, navigating now the waters of death. Pablo Neruda, Ode to a Large Tuna in the Market. Author's note. In this book, I use the terms fisherman and fishermen to refer to both men and women engaged in the act of catching fish, despite the fact that those labels largely obscure the latter's massive importance within global fisheries. Women compose half the world's total working population in the seafood industry. Throughout my reporting, many women I interviewed expressed preference for the moniker. I have also used the gender-neutral angler when appropriate. For clarity, I've used imperial pounds for fish prices and weights, reflecting current industry practice in many parts of the world. Otherwise, I've used metric units, tons, for instance, throughout. Prologue, an ending. In the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, between swells of blue-gray water, the sky is a dome over a dinner plate, vast and variable. The horizon's flatness cleaves a line through the elements, a trick of perspective obscuring the Earth's true curvature. On an unpredictable sea, the permanence of that line, its physical declaration of up and down, anchors a reality a seafarer can cling to, a reality without which she, or you, or I, could lose herself. At exactly 45 degrees west longitude, between the coasts of North America and Europe, and hundreds of kilometers from the nearest land, there's another line. This one cuts the ocean perpendicular to the horizon and runs vertically from surface to seafloor. Plummeting downward along this vertical cross-section, dropping through watery layers, white sprays are tossed from wavetops. Clouds of plankton and krill drift languidly. The sunlight fades and eventually disappears. Spidery starfish creep along the sandy seafloor past lurking wolffish. From spitting surface to deepest undersea canyon, these strata take shape in my imagination, like a painting in one of my son's picture books. Ever since this line at the 45-degree west meridian was invented by humans, it has dictated the fortunes and fate of Atlantic bluefin tuna, one of our planet's most spectacular and vital apex predators. The line is also entirely theoretical, except to the extent that it controls a billion-dollar industry and has allowed humans to run roughshod over one of the world's most contested species for decades. Atlantic bluefin tuna, Tunis tinus, have lived for millions of years in our physical world and captured human imaginations long before the written word. Ancient peoples trapped bluefin in shallows and killed them with rocks and sticks. Greeks and Phoenicians immortalized the economically important fish in art and theater, and even stamped its image on early currency. Bluefin are charismatic megafauna, a category of large, big-eyed beasts, including elephants, lions, and whales, that serve as placeholders in the public imagination, and have come to represent the health of our oceans and the overfishing that besieges them. Compared with floppy, schooling fish, giant bluefin are more machine than fuel, more predator than prey. I was in my mid-20s when I first saw one in person, and it fit my idea of fish as much as a dinosaur resembles a chickadee. There was, from that initial impression, a problem of scale. The largest tuna ever caught weighed 1,496 pounds. If you can imagine a grand piano shaped like a nuclear weapon. To stand beside a just-landed giant bluefin still slick from salt water. Feels akin to standing beside a natural marvel like Niagara Falls or an erupting volcano. There's beauty, but also danger. Every late summer and early fall, schools of gorgeous, massive bluefin rocket along North America's Atlantic coast. They are an advanced rod-and-reel sport fisherman's fish. Catching one requires time and a full set of pricey and intensely specific gear, including a volleyball-sized brass reel built to handle a tuna's heft. Some fishermen call bluefin marauders, others racers. The genus name Tunis, after all, comes from the ancient Greek word tunno, rush. Throughout the mid and late 1970s, the world's three bluefin tuna populations, Atlantic, Pacific, and Southern, plunged globally because of rampant overfishing, largely due to demand for the sushi-grade fish in Japan. In 1981, two dozen tuna fishing countries made their first move to restrict the trade, drawing a line down the middle of the Atlantic Ocean during a meeting hosted by the Spanish government in Madrid. That line ran from the southernmost tip of Greenland, zigzagged around Brazil's rocky bulge, then progressed south off the map toward Antarctica. Starting the following year, all bluefin caught to the right of the line toward Europe and North Africa would be considered eastern fish, while all to the left would be western. At the time, prevailing scientific thought held that the powerful, warm-blooded fish largely gravitated back to the coastlines where they were born, with eastern fish spawning in the balmy Mediterranean and their western counterparts in the Gulf of Mexico. Overnight, this conceptual line transformed the fisheries for Atlantic bluefin tuna. Toward the European side of the Atlantic Ocean, harvest remained a free-for-all, with no quotas on how many fish could be caught and killed for the countries that had historically fished those waters. Toward North America, for countries including the United States and Canada, and for historical reasons, Japan, not a single fish, other than those purportedly caught for scientific purposes, could be legally caught. Called the two-stock theory, this understanding of how tuna breed and migrate as two almost entirely separate populations set the stage for how Atlantic bluefin have been protected and managed for the entirety of my lifetime. Growing up in a leafy suburb abutting Lake Ontario, I learned how to catch and gut a fish before I knew how to blow-dry my hair or paint my nails. My father, Don, a successful businessman and scientist, had spent his own childhood angling on rural rivers and lakes with his farmer parents and wanted to pass along his love of fishing to me and my two younger siblings. We spent summers jamming oozing worms onto hooks, threading bobbers, and paddling to find the best fishing holes. Fishing, he lectured, was a controllable craft and act of human will, hypothesis testing, and logic, with results you could eat for supper. In this and other ways, raising us alongside my chemist mother, he tried to teach us about the immutable, final authority of science. In contrast, I wanted to write poetry, or maybe books, captivated by our world's living systems and its nuanced, pulsing rhythms. My parents rolled their eyes at my earnestness. Still, I refused to give up my dream of being a writer. Curious about food, I enrolled in culinary school and used that training to write about chefs and restaurants while earning extra money cooking and catering. Once, a fisherman supplied a 3-foot-long bluefin tuna to a restaurant where I worked, forcing me to search online for an instructional video on how to butcher the pricey fish. Before inserting my razor-sharp knife along its backbone, I stroked its metallic, glossy sides, marveling at its heft and beauty. With dense, red flesh, it was nothing like the flimsy perch and bass I had grown up catching. Once I had cut and vacuum-sealed the bluefin slabbed steaks, they all sold out within hours. I scraped extra flesh from the carcass with a spoon and used it to make a marinated Hawaiian poke. I heaped the unctuous result onto tortilla chips, the richness of its flavor mingling with salty soy sauce and fiery chilies. I felt thankful and lucky. In my early 30s, in the months before I gave birth to my son, my father was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. I found out he was dying on an unexpected video call from my family, who had gathered to break the news.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.